And welcome to another episode of Palette Chats, where today I am joined by Denzel Stephenson. He's a sculptor attending SCAD here in Atlanta. Right now we are in the studio surrounded by all of his wood pieces, and I'm excited to hear more about your work. So yeah. Tell us a bit about yourself.
Well, thanks for having me. Mm-hmm. I'm a senior here at SCAD now, finishing up the end of May here, so I'm just trying to get all these last pieces done, finish up.
Graduate.
Got our senior exhibition next quarter, so
nice.
Excited for that.
Yeah. So, can you tell them a little bit about your work and what it is that you make?
Yeah, I mean, so I guess to give a little context, I grew up in Colorado mostly spent my time as a bike racer.
Yeah.
So, my work kind of draws a lot from my experiences of that, riding in the mountains and building trails with friends and stuff. So, kind of use a lot of raw materials, a lot of raw wood, and like to collect for my pieces. So, like to keep it all natural stuff that I'm able to find and collect myself.
And you work with metals as well, right?
A little bit. Mostly use like steel and stuff if I need to make some sort of frame to like more of as a display kind of thing or something. I have done some bronze stuff in the past for fun and some experiments and stuff, but as of now I'm sticking really to just materials I can find. I just like the process of like going out. Usually when I'm out riding I'll see something that looks interesting or a tree that's fallen on the trail that I need to clear out anyway, so it's a good opportunity to use for a project.
Yeah.
And it's all free, so
yeah,
it's pretty good.
That's even better, absolutely.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
So what was a defining moment when you chose to start using those pieces for art?
I mean, I guess since I came to SCAD, it's kind of been stuff I've been drawn to, I guess, since the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
But especially once we started getting more freedom, like as you get through your classes, you kind of start getting more freedom with what you get to, as far as materials you get to use or concepts you want to explore. So really once we started getting the chance to do what we wanted more, it was just like a natural process for me to just be drawn to those things. So
you started the series more like in college rather than like back in high school, or like
I didn't do any art really until just before coming to SCAD.
So what brought you to SCAD?
The cycling team?
Okay, yeah.
So my girlfriend, she had been interested in studying graphic design and had been talking with the coach here at SCAD, and she got offered a scholarship to come, and then she told the coach about me as well, and then it kind of just worked out that we both got offered scholarships to come to SCAD, so I figured might as well come try it out, because you don't get those opportunities every day, so.
No, that's awesome.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's amazing.
So it's kind of just been a whole new chapter in my life, coming to SCAD and moving here and getting into art and stuff, so.
And getting to find that balance between what you're making and that passion of cycling. And,
yeah.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. That's awesome.
It's been cool.
How are you expanding on that now?
On just my making art and stuff?
Yeah, like on combining both of those things and doing more work.
Yeah, I mean, it's been, so I guess when I was 19 or 20, I'd been racing, I mean, I started racing when I was like 8 years old, so it's been like, I've been doing that forever, and then I got mono when I was 19, I believe, and I kind of had to take a break from racing to recover from that, and in that time, I kind of realized cycling wasn't the only thing in the world to do with your time, and I was kind of over just the whole mentality of just training and racing all the time. So I kind of stopped racing after that, and I went back to school. I was going to school in Colorado, and that's where I met my girlfriend. One of my friends, he was into painting, and I had kind of done a little bit of painting with him, and that's really what kind of got me interested in art in the first, like from the very beginning, and then shortly after that is when we came to SCAD.
Yeah.
But now, coming here, I've had to get back into racing because of the team and stuff, but it's been nice to do collegiate racing because it's a lot less stressful than the racing I was doing before coming here. So it's been, it's felt a lot more balanced as far as the stress levels, at least around riding. I can kind of still just ride how I would for fun almost, and just, and still go to the races, and it's all good. So definitely now that I've gotten farther along in my degree, it's, the sculpture stuff's been taking more and more time.
Yeah.
Just been more committed and bigger projects and everything, so the balance has shifted definitely more towards my work at this point. I mean, I still ride all the time and stuff, but it's just not as, like, quite as intense as what I was doing when I first came back into racing, so.
Yeah, kind of working in seasons, trying to decide, like, where to put your time, where to put your efforts.
Yeah, definitely. So, mm-hmm. Yeah, it's been good, though.
Yeah. So, what do you think it's going to be like once you graduate?
I'm not really sure. It's kind of, fine arts degree is kind of hard to, or it's a daunting process of, like,
yeah.
making it a profession.
What to do with this degree, sort of
yeah.
thing? Yeah.
But I kind of want to do sculpture because I feel like it gave me a lot of hard skills that I can use mm-hmm. towards a lot of different jobs. So if the fine art thing doesn't work out, or if I don't have immediate success out of mm-hmm. college, I guess I could see myself doing a lot of different jobs, like fabricating jobs, or
yeah,
I've done construction stuff before,
here, like
so.
You said.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, also with my background in cycling, I can do bike mechanic stuff or whatever, really. So, not super stressed about finding a job, but, you know, I guess I'm kind of open to a lot of different things at this point.
Yeah.
Just going to kind of see how things go after the end of this year. And
kind of seeing where that flow kind of takes you.
Yeah. I do want to keep still doing some sculpture stuff
mm-hmm.
on my own time and stuff. So yeah, we'll see how things progress from here.
Yeah. I'm trying to kind of cast a net to see where other students are going to be going after here. Do you think that you would stay in Atlanta?
Yeah, I think my plan right now is to stay around here. I'm also in a band here, so mm-hmm. I kind of want to see how things with that progress. And
yeah, tell us more about that one. Yeah, sorry, I haven't gotten to hear a lot about this, and I only
yeah.
just learned this, so I'm excited.
Yeah, our band's called Das Kaiser. Our front man, he also goes to SCAD here. He's mm-hmm. a grad student in illustration, also on the cycling team, so that's how we met and started playing together and stuff.
Okay.
So I honestly, I'd only played guitar like a really little bit before coming here, so the past couple years I've learned a lot playing with Willem, and it's kind of progressed quite rapidly, and now we're playing shows and stuff, so it's been a crazy adventure. And
okay,
that's,
and this is all over the past year or a couple of years?
Really in the past, I guess since the summer when I came back after the break is when we started, is when I was started playing with the band and stuff. And
yeah. Are you guys doing original songs?
Yep. Mm-hmm. We do some covers. Like, depending on the show, like, if we play at a bar or something, we'll do some covers because people know them and they're into them, but
yeah.
for the most part, we play all original stuff.
What draws you to music?
I mean, I guess I kind of wanted to learn guitar for a while, and then a couple years ago, I was like, well, if I'm going to learn it, I might as well just start trying to do it, so
yeah.
I basically learned, everything I've learned has been off of YouTube or something.
YouTube University is the best.
Yeah.
Yeah.
it does wonders, so just learning stuff from there, just playing along with songs, kind of taught me how to just play the basic chords and whatever, and then since I started playing with Willem more, he's really showed me, I guess just playing with other people really increases your learning rate quite quickly, so just from that I've learned a lot, and then the more I've gotten into it, the more fun it's been, and I just like the process of learning new stuff, so it's been fun.
Do you ever freeze before starting something you've never done before?
Like a new song or something, or?
Like picking up a new material or a new hobby or things like that.
I feel like I'm pretty good at just jumping into it, because, yeah, I don't know, I like learning new things and new skills, and I guess, things go wrong, it's don't put too much pressure on it, so I just kind of mm-hmm. I just kind of keep it fun. So
what's
yeah.
probably like one of your favorite things over the past couple of years?
I mean, between the sculpture and music uh-huh. stuff, like this, that's kind of been my whole
going
life recently.
And
yeah. yeah, and it's just both of them have like taken off more than I mm-hmm. totally would have expected from the start. So between those two things, it's been an adventure. It's been pretty
awesome.
Fun.
Yeah.
Yeah. So I guess those mm-hmm. those two things have been my biggest passions recently.
Yeah, and I also know that you've been dabbling in printmaking. Have you done
a little bit? No.
Oh, yeah.
So these prints here behind us are the mm-hmm. first prints I made. I had wanted to take a printmaking class here at SCAD, but the way my schedules worked out and the credits and all that, I just wasn't able to make it an actual class. So
yeah.
I figured I would just try to do it myself. And I had this really sweet log that I had split, and I was going to use it for a piece, and I wanted to, at first I thought about just trying to get good photos of it because the wood grain was so cool and textured that I just wanted to have some documentation of it, but then I figured I'm kind of running out of time here, so I just wanted to try to make a print and see how it went.
Yeah.
And they turned out great. I'm happy
yeah,
with how they
really
how
cool.
they came out. So
yeah.
Robert, the printmaking professor, was
mm-hmm.
gave me some tips and
oh,
help
yeah.
me out, help me get started, and so
yeah,
it came out great.
I was sitting in the studio, and then all of a sudden, I look over, and you had like the big like block of wood that
yeah.
you're moving around on this like cart and moving it through the studio,
yeah.
and I just see him like pulling these big sheets out with this incredible texture on it, and I was like, what is he doing? What the?
Yeah.
It was so cool because you don't see a lot of people bringing in materials that are, you know, obscure or just interesting, and so
mm-hmm.
that's always really refreshing to see.
Yeah.
Especially when it's a successful.
Yeah. Yeah, I think Robert was stoked to have something random like that come into, because I mean, it's pretty large scale, different materials, and
mm-hmm.
I think he was pretty excited about the process too, because he hadn't really done something like that
yeah.
himself, so we had fun doing it. Yeah.
Do you have any more pieces that you're thinking about doing that again with, or?
Yeah, I mean, I kind of want to incorporate it as part of my process now. If like whenever I start a new piece and I have a piece of wood or something that I'm into, I want to make a print of it and almost have it as more like a documentation kind of thing.
Yeah.
And like, I guess if it works conceptually with the piece, that can be displayed
mm-hmm.
with the final piece, or just have them.
It's a really unique
for myself
and fun
to,
way of documenting it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's pretty cool. Yeah.
And then where did that specific piece come from?
That piece of wood.
Mm-hmm.
So, actually, the same place I got these railroad ties from.
Yeah.
There was this preschool down the street from my house, and this big oak tree had fallen over. Yeah, like it was in one of the crazy storms
mm-hmm.
a few months ago.
Like where we had all the tornadoes and stuff.
Yeah,
yeah.
And it blew over this huge, really nice oak tree, and it ripped up part of their playground.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what these railroad ties were for. They were like holding.
Oh.
They were like a retaining wall to hold the sandbox in or something like that. And I had ridden by it and I saw the tree, so I went and asked them if I could take some of it.
Mm-hmm.
And they were like, yeah, take whatever you want. So
yeah,
I grabbed that piece, and then I grabbed these railroad ties too because they were all ripped up out of the ground. So kind of got two in one from that
yeah.
little excursion.
Are there, yeah, what all is around us right now in the studio? Like what do you usually keep here?
Yeah, I mean, we just had to clean out a lot of stuff because we have SCAD Day coming up. We had to kind of tidy up our studios, but I just brought these in today because we're going to reinstall them for the fine art exhibition that's coming up in a week or two. So this is going to be a piece that I'm going to set up. I have these prints still hanging here. And then back here, this is the piece of wood that I made those prints from. So I split it into
yeah.
a bunch of pieces. And then I have a bucket of dirt back there, and just some random plywood and other 2x4s and stuff that I have on hand if I need it.
All I can think of is Jack Sparrow's. I've got a jar of dirt. I apologize.
Yeah.
That's why I'm laughing. What was it you said that you had back there?
There's just more random scraps of wood. I just
hid
them behind the plywood so that it looks clean in here.
Yeah.
But
what's the plan for all of this?
Well, all this plywood I used for the last project, I had to build a big wall to block off one of the gallery spaces back there. So now there's just, I had to deconstruct the wall, and so I just have all the wood here. Because a lot of times I'll need a little piece of wood or piece of plywood or 2x4 or something, and then I have to like go back home and get something and bring it here, but I've just started stashing it all here, so I just have it if I need it.
What is your process like for choosing specific pieces?
Usually it starts when I'm out on a ride or something, and I'll, because there's so many trees here in Atlanta, and there's a lot of times trees get blown over or something, or there's like a sick tree that's just gone. Like usually it's something that's just fallen over and it's blocking a trail that I'm riding or something. So I just kind of like to get materials from the places that I ride a lot or places that I visit and go to a lot. So that's kind of where a lot of my pieces start, is almost out of necessity of having to move something, like cut up a tree to move, and then I'll just use that as my material, and then I'll kind of figure out what I want to make from it from there.
What are some of the challenges that you've like faced collecting materials this way?
I mean, the biggest challenge is like moving a big heavy tree by myself.
Yeah.
Like, so
have
sometimes,
you ever had to call for help?
Yeah, I've had some friends come and help me move some things. Like I had an 8-foot trunk of a tree that I had to bring in here last quarter, so I had to get a couple buddies to help me get that. That's like the main issue most of the time, is just how I'm gonna move these things, especially because I don't have like an excavator or something to just go snatch it up with. But that's a big challenge. I guess it's just hard work to go cut these things up. I have to use a chainsaw to usually cut the pieces I want on site first, so that I move as little as I really need to. Those are really the main challenges. It's just the scale.
If there is like, if anybody watching this wanted to start doing this, what are some tips that you would give them and some things to avoid?
Yeah, I guess the biggest tip, I suppose, would be like not trying to force something to be something that you want it to be, I guess.
Yeah.
Like, that's why I like to get my materials from places that I actually go to a lot, because I feel like I have more of a connection to that space, and I kind of know, I've like seen more of the history of what's been going on there, and I know why something's, why these materials are there in the first place. And it, like, because I feel like if you go somewhere and you just start cutting up a tree or something, like, unless you know, like, what's been going on there more, like, it could be someone else's land or something. I don't know. I guess knowing the area that you're going to is important, to just make sure you're not encroaching on anyone's space
or
taking someone's.
Yeah, or about to get in trouble for taking something or messing with something.
So far, I haven't had any run-ins with people being mad about anything, but you never know.
Do you have any like pieces of wood or materials that you carry like cross borders, like stuff from back in Colorado that you have here or anything like that?
Not really. I've kind of, when I moved out here, I tried to take as little as possible. And at that point, I didn't really know what I was getting into coming here. So basically everything I've used has been, I've collected from a pretty small area around where I live, so.
But that's cool. Yeah. It's like little like time stamps.
Yeah.
Of where you've been and what you've gotten to see.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I like that a lot, because I know a lot of people, especially in school, can struggle getting to know the area that they're in because they're so busy. And you've got a really great advantage being on the second team and getting to get out there and getting to see other things. And
I
think it's incredible how you've taken advantage of that.
Definitely. Yeah. I mean, also riding my bike places, I found I get a much more intimate and like closer up understanding of like our area. Like I know a lot of people that drive everywhere, and they just, most of the time they don't even know where things are in the city.
Just listening to the directions and just like.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And I remember one time I was giving my friend a ride to his house, and he just told me the area that he lived in. And I just drove him over there, and he's like, how did you get here, and you didn't use a map or anything? I was like, well, I just know where things are, yeah. So just from riding around, and you find all these cool little connections, and like how to connect little neighborhoods, and yeah, there's so much cool stuff to find mm-hmm. on like by foot or by bike that you don't get to see on your car, so.
Yeah, that's why I think I love walking. I prefer walking mm-hmm. to driving almost every single time.
Yeah. Yeah, every time I have to drive here to bring materials or something, I immediately regret it.
<It's> so
as soon as I get in the traffic.
It's so annoying.
Yeah.
What are some pieces that you could shout out right now?
My most recent piece is called Divided, where I made these prints for. And then I'm gonna have these, this railroad tie piece set up in the back gallery here. So you can check those out over the next month or so, though they should be up. And also at the main building, I have a couple pieces up on the fifth floor. And all my pieces I have on my website too, so.
Yeah, absolutely, give your website a shout out.
So I haven't bought like mm-hmm. a URL for it yet, so it's
oh,
like
yeah,
a crazy name, so maybe
most
we'll
of
just put a link
have
or
not.
Something.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Oh yeah, I can put the link for it.
Yeah,
absolutely.
I honestly don't know the whole,
yeah.
all the numbers
but
and
you
stuff.
Also have your Instagram as well, right?
Yeah, uh-huh. I actually don't really use any social media. I, mm-hmm. I actually had to make that Instagram for a class.
Yeah.
So, but that has my stuff on it too. Mm-hmm. It's at stevenson.sculpture. Yeah, I mean, I don't typically check it very much because, yeah, social media to me has just been a thing that I just haven't, since I stopped racing and I used to have to do a lot of like sponsored posts and stuff like this
okay.
for, and like once I was done with that, I was like, no more social media, I'm over it.
Yeah.
Which I know isn't the most practical approach for an artist, but I'm doing my best, so.
No,
I'll try to.
If you don't need it, then you don't need it.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
But I mean, I guess if people want to reach out on there, I'll see it eventually. So, yeah.
No, I think that's absolutely true. I think that a lot of us forget we don't need social media for our work to mean something.
Yeah.
And you can continue working and continue creating.
Definitely.
And the backhand side of that is we don't know that because people who aren't posting aren't posting, and so you don't realize that that's an option.
Yeah.
Yeah. But just remembering that.
Yeah, for sure. I mean, I do see the value of promoting your work online and like the connections that you can make and the wider audience you can get from it.
What do you do in your free time?
I mean, there's at this point I barely have any free time between the band and work and training and stuff. Like, I mean, that kind of takes up all my time.
I think a better question would be, how do you recharge?
Yeah, I mean, I guess music for me has been my main source of just like not stressing.
Yeah.
Sometimes if we have a show coming up or something, I'll start getting in the headspace of like, well, I need to like, you know, really get dialed and like get all my parts figured out and like and stuff. But for the most part, music has kind of been my thing that I don't put any pressure on and just do for fun. So.
Do you guys have any more shows coming up within the next 2 weeks?
Not in the next week. We just finished our last show, mm-hmm. or we did a show last week, and that was our last one for a while now, because mm-hmm. We had a bunch lined up, and then we had to cancel them all because we have a bunch of races coming up
mm-hmm.
That just happened to be on all the same dates that we had those shows. So,
oh, okay.
Yeah. But I'm sure we'll have something that comes up somewhat soon. That
yeah.
Something we play at Ideal Sports Bar a lot. That's in like South Atlanta. They have like a cool little country music scene going on there, so might play there sometime soon, but
yeah.
As of right now, don't have anything lined up, but I'll let you know if we do.
Perfect, yep,
yeah.
Let me know.
Yeah.
And how about anything with like shows or anything like that?
Yeah, well, we'll have our senior exhibition show
yeah.
next quarter. I want to do a DIY show at some point and just do my own whole thing, but I haven't had time to really plan that out yet. But at some point I'd like to do, yeah, like my own solo show or something and get all my pieces in one spot, which I think would be really nice because so far I've only been able to do group shows, which is fun too, and it's a good experience, but I feel like seeing all my work in one spot would be more impactful and it would give everything more of a context of, like, I guess what it means and the mm-hmm. yeah, the whole scope of, like,
yeah,
my work
and
is
a larger sense of kind of what you're trying to do and
yeah.
what you're trying to say.
Yeah. Yeah. So I'm gonna try to line something up like that at some point. We'll see how that goes.
So for sculpture, what are the steps that you have to take for the senior show?
The biggest thing is just getting pieces that are you want to show and are worthy to show at like a official thing like that.
Are there like number requirements or just like I don't know? Yeah. Like, do you have to have a certain number of pieces that you're showing?
I'm not really sure because since it's going to be a big group show, I'm assuming we're only going to be able to pick one or maybe two pieces.
Mm-hmm.
Especially all my stuff is quite large scale, so I guess it's going to come down to the venue that we mm-hmm. choose and how much space we'll have to actually, like how much stuff we can fit in there. So
yeah.
I guess we'll have to wait and see how that lines up, because that'll be a whole group project to figure that one out between all the painters and the other sculpture majors and stuff. So.
Do you have any pieces that you would pick now, like if you had to do it tomorrow, that you would like love to show?
Yeah, I mean this divided one, I really like, honestly have like quite a few pieces that I'm pretty stoked on and I feel like they're all cohesive. The Wheelbarrow Man, I don't know if you've seen that one. That
love
one,
that.
Everyone loves
yeah.
that one.
That
was one of my favorite
forest,
ones
yeah.
too. It's a wheelbarrow that I carved the legs out of a tulip tree. And so he's standing up, Wheelbarrow Man thing. I don't know how to really describe it.
Yeah,
but
how did you come up with that one?
That one started with the concept I wanted to do something about the toll that labor takes on your body through all this physical labor, like the processes of making these sculptures and stuff.
Mm-hmm.
Like I was saying, it's hard work to get all these big trees and bring them here to the studio and work on them. And I guess also reflecting on the history of being a cyclist and basically my body was my tool for work for a long time. So I wanted to make something that kind of captured the sense of the fragility of the human body and the yeah, it kind of shows the wear and tear that labor takes. And I found that wheelbarrow at a site that I ride at a lot, and the tree was at the same site as well. So that one was all collected at the same location, all the materials. And I don't use any sort of finishes on my wood. I like to keep them all raw, and it shows that the checking that happens in the wood and the yeah, kind of the natural processes of that wood breaking down and stuff. So that one kind of encapsulates all that.
Letting it continue to do what it was doing before, basically.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And that's also conceptually important to me, is that, like, it theoretically, if one of these pieces ended up in a museum or something, like, at some point down the line in history, I feel like it's still going to turn into, it's still going to be waste at some point. So I want as much of my materials to be able to just go back and just, you know, decompose back to where they came from.
Turn back into dust.
Yeah, because you know, if I sealed them up with a bunch of finishes and stuff, it would kind of take away from that aspect of it. So.
And then
so.
What's the other piece that's up on the floor?
That one's titled Butchered. It's referencing the meat industry and kind of these social, I guess, norms that we have about, you know, eating meat and like big, yeah, I guess the big industry of producing meat,
yeah.
And just like comparing that to our views on wood as a resource, because, you know, people are really passionate about animal rights and being vegan or vegetarian and all this stuff, but no one's really, I mean, deforestation is obviously a big topic, but I feel like they're kind of viewed as two separate things
when
really they're kind of
yeah,
pretty much the same.
Like,
yeah, so
yeah,
I cut it down the middle to kind of look like a cattle that's been butchered,
yeah.
And I hung it up with meat hooks that I made, and yeah, it's on this, it's like suspended in the air, so it kind of looks like a cattle being butchered.
Yeah.
So
I think it really helps, especially for anyone that's listening. Like, if you are not watching this right now, definitely go to the website and see it, because it's an incredibly powerful piece, and it looks just like a meat hook holding, like a cattle body.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think that you executed that idea perfectly.
Yeah, that one took a lot of thinking about it and trying to figure out how I wanted to make that image come to reality.
How much did you have to adjust the wood itself, or cut away, or add to it?
The wood was honestly not too much. I had to first I had to cut it down the middle with the chainsaw, so that wasn't too difficult. And then I basically stripped off all the bark, because that tree, once you take the bark off, it has these like crazy, it almost looks like a cowhide, like once you remove the skin off a cow,
yeah.
Like it has this striated, like textured look to it.
Mm-hmm.
And then I had to carve out the hole for the post to go through the two pieces. And then a big part of that one was all the hooks that I made for that. I forged those myself, so I used like railroad ties railroad spikes that I'd found.
Mm-hmm.
And I forged those, so that was a process.
Yeah.
It's a lot of hammering. My hand got pretty chewed up from that one. I had blisters, because it was like, I spent like a whole day just hammering,
mm-hmm.
hammering away at those. But I guess as far as the wood went, that was relatively, I guess, little work compared to the metalworking. And I had to also weld up this big frame to suspend it onto, so.
Yeah, and it feels like your concept was confirmed through the process of creating it too, like the way that you're describing the bark as being all skinned off and,
mm-hmm.
and all these other things.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I think that's incredible from start to finish.
I mean, one of my favorite parts about, I guess, the whole process of making these sculptures is I'll start out with a kind of a rough idea of what I want to make, and even if it's a pretty thought out idea, I always find that once I start working,
mm-hmm.
things really develop a lot and like can kind of lead in a different direction than what I had imagined from the start. And like learning about the actual wood itself, and like, yeah, there's a lot, like the stripping of the bark wasn't something I had really planned, but once I'd done a little test piece, and once I took the bark off of that and I saw how it looked underneath, like that was a big development in like the actual look of that whole piece itself. So
yeah, that final piece.
Yeah, I mean, like
stripping it bare. Yeah.
Yeah, I feel like a lot of people get kind of worried about things like that, where I've seen where you're looking into a process and things aren't going exactly how they imagined. But to me, that's kind of one of the best things about it, is that you're like constantly learning and finding new things.
Speak to you.
Yeah,
yes,
exactly.
I love that.
Yeah. So, and then there's definitely a point where you just have to kind of, you can't just keep going in different directions. Like you have to, like there's a window where you're kind of exploring a lot and things are developing, and then you have to bring it all together at the end.
Yeah.
So yeah, that's the whole process is really fun, and it's been a good thing to learn and get into.
Have you ever had to just toss a piece?
Not really. That's one of the things I pride myself on, is that I've never not finished something, a piece, where at least a piece that I've really been into and like passionate about. Like I feel like I'm always able to bring it together at the end in a way that is cohesive and, for the most part, achieves the goals that I wanted to do in the piece. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is there any like final stories or like one of your favorite stories from making one of your pieces?
At this point, this is just like,
you're normal.
It's just kind of normal to me, just to like the whole process of finding these materials and figuring out how to collect them and bring them here.
I'll finish it on my phone.
Yeah. Like I feel like most people would be like, wow, that's like, why are you doing all this? Like
yeah.
it's you could just do a much simpler process to make something different, but
not for you.
Yeah, that's what I like about it, is like, just all the all these different aspects, like outside of the studio, all these things I have to do to make these pieces happen. It's kind of like, that's what makes it special to me, is that it's not just what I do in here. It's like, it really connects the both of these spaces together. So
yeah, connecting out there to in here.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Thank you so much for being on today. I've really enjoyed getting to dive deeper into your mind.
Yeah, thank you.
And I hope that we could do this again once the show is ready to go up in 10 weeks.
Yeah.
I would love to do another feature and have you back on, if that's all right.
For sure.
Okay,
thank you.
Perfect.
Thanks for having me. It's been good.
Thank you, guys. Again, go check out his website. Go check out his work. Go see it all on Palette Chats as well. And I'll see you in the next video.